So now I'm going to change my cap and I'm going to talk to you in my position of chairman of the board for the European Processor Initiative. So as I did mention, the European Processor Initiative is really the cornerstone of the European Union in high-end computing. The overall research and development budget for EPI is in the range of 130 million euros for covering IP development with, let's say, two batch of money. The current one, about 80 million euros, and there will be a second one that will be covered by the FP9 budget. So this is all the money coming from the new commission. That will be by around 50 million euros for the years 2022 and 2023. So I guess that now you are quite familiar also with the concept of European processor. In this presentation, I've got a short introduction, and then I will go more into the technical details, and that will be the first time I give some more details about the technology inside the hood, right below the hood. So there are different objectives, complementary objectives. The first one, and this is what is in the last part, this is to redevelop in Europe high-end expertise in microprocessor development. Today, Europe is under risk of embargo. I will not make any political comment about it, but this is a fact that if there is a big economical war around the world, Europe is not in a good position. So Europe has decided to be back in this area of high-end segment. So high-end segment means at first supercomputers to drive the technology, but not only. With the rise of edge computing and autonomous vehicles, and car manufacturing industry is by far the number one vertical in Europe, so Europe has to control its future in this industry, in this vertical. So if we assume that the future is with car with a lot of autonomy, lot of electronic components, cars will become, let's say, computers on wheels. This is an image that we use very often. So let's say the high-end segment of edge computing, what we call edge HPC, has to be covered by that initiative. So this is the overall objective. And for doing that, obviously, we don't intend at first to get in Europe a manufacturing plant with the top manufacturing processes in the 7 nano, 6 nano, 5 nano or more, because the cost of such factory is so huge, and the time you need to cover your cost when you build up such a factory is so long, with a load on the factory that is so high, that no way that on the short term Europe decide to invest $30 billion or more in such a factory. So at first the objective is to be back at least at the IP level. So the goal is to develop IP, and if we want to be with a short-term success for exascale edges, no way we can develop from scratch our own IP. So we are very pragmatic, and we decided for general purpose processor to recreate expertise in Europe based on ARM IP. At least this is an IP vendor owned by a Japanese company, but that was invented in Europe. So it's quite neutral to positive from a European standpoint. On a side of that, we start redeveloping our own IP based on RISC-V. And will RISC-V be a success on the long term? We believe it, but obviously there are other alternatives. Nobody knows how long it will take for the RISC-V ecosystem in mid-range to high-end to rise. But anyway, let's say we bet on RISC-V, we have to do something. And at first, for the first generation for exascale computing, we develop, let's say, a simplistic RISC-V accelerator, because it's quite simple to develop in terms of IP block for microprocessor. And that will be devoted to double precision operations and to get some deep learning features. And based on those technological bricks, we also develop a platform for edge computing and for autonomous vehicles. And obviously, all of that is also in the mainstream of the current technology with artificial intelligence, big data, and all the current features that we need if we want to get some products that are economically viable. So we believe very much that the overall message is sovereignty, and that developing for the high end will help to cover the all needs. At first, obviously, we have core drivers for high-end computing, for automotive, and for servers and cloud, while this last segment is less important for us. We also think that artificial intelligence and big data, it's not only buzzword. We have seen this morning that it's becoming really a central piece for each high-end supercomputing center. But we also consider that on the long term, for critical and safety activities around industry 4.0, robotics, on space, on aerospace, that's very important to rely on the technology we develop in Europe. So this is a core driving directions that we follow for all of our developments. So the way we develop is quite simple with EPI. Co-design. Co-design is the key word for everything, for hardware, for software, security. And when I say security, it's security everywhere by design. No security, no sovereignty. This is a concept. So in any IP we develop, in any process we put in place, security is absolutely crucial. It's also related to the European regulations with the GDPR, which is very important for us in Europe. We want to protect the data of the citizens, the private life of the citizen. We want to protect the European industry and the economical data. It's getting so important that for us, safety is definitively something we implement at any stage of the process. And we use that co-design concept with hardware, software, security for three specific verticals, HPC at first, on automotive, on edge HPC. So the big question after that, once we have developed the IP, is how to transform the IP that we develop for a microprocessor into real products that we can have in a supercomputer. So the question is from IP to products, so from EPI, which is a consortium, to a commercial company that has been created and incorporated quite recently in June, that will take the IP developed by EPI, add some specific IP, develop a product line, manufacture microprocessors and accelerators, and sell those microprocessors and accelerators to any company who wants to use them and to want to make business at least in Europe. So Cyper, I'm one of the founder of the company, by the way, will work with all supercomputer vendors and server vendors. So it could be obviously in Europe, a company like Ethos, which is the only one, unfortunately. That could be IBM, that could be Dell, that could be HPE, that could be Lenovo, that could be Huawei. There is absolutely no restriction. As long as this is European technology, everyone is welcome to work in Europe. You are welcome. So, again, I will not go into the details, just to give a side word about the complexity to set up a company in Europe in the industry. Let's say the venture capitals are not willing very much to invest big money in small companies for industrial projects with long-term return on their investment. It's not in the ventures, let's say, culture in Europe. And quite funny, we receive many calls from China, and they tell us, guys, if you want money, just ask. Quite funny. I like it, but no, this is not what we want. And when we come to the US to discuss with ventures, at least in the US, the culture is really open to make some risk for long-term industrial investments. So congratulations for your culture on this. But at least it works. So now let's move to a roadmap on technology. So this is a slide that has been used, but you have some new words on these slides. So you have to have in mind the last version. So what is new is first, here. For ARM, we are going to work with a Zeus core. Don't ask any detail because I cannot disclose. I just got the agreement from ARM to disclose the name of the core. But this is the most advanced core they have ever designed. And we are going to work with TSMC on their so-called 6-nanometer manufacturing process. And we are going to make a refresh in terms of technology with the Zeus Plus core in 5-nanometer and with the industrial version of our own accelerator, and the code name of our accelerator is Titan. So all of that is quite new as an information. And what is also new is the fact that in the second half of 2021, we are going to release the same way we did with the Mont Blanc 3 project, two prototype motherboards that we intend to produce in not in volume, but a few thousand of units, with a PCI Express board that will be manufactured by E4, it's an Italian company, which is part of the consortium, that will be pluggable into a workstation, and that will contain the processor and everything you need to work with. The goal is to have enough seed units for laboratories and industrial companies who want to start working with the European technology. And at the same time, Atos is developing a board for their Bulleix Sequana supercomputer range for the equipment of the exascale prototypes. And all of that will be with the, let's say, the beta version of our Rhea microprocessor. And the Rhea microprocessor is the one using Zeus core. And a bit later, for the exascale systems, then there will be the European exascale supercomputings, the edge version of our microprocessor for autonomous vehicles that will use Kronos, which is the update of the general purpose processor, on Titan, which is the update, the industrial version of our accelerator. So let's have a look on the global architecture of the microprocessor. It's very conceptual at this stage, but it gives you some hints about what we develop. So you've got, let's say, a concept of interposers on which we plug, in brackets, tiles. And there are some tiles which are those cores, some others the European accelerators, and one tile of the European accelerator is indeed, let's say, a complete ecosystem on its own with micro tiles containing the accelerator itself, plus a specific NOC, NOC, the network on chip, for making the glue between the micro tiles and connecting to the global NOC. And the MPPA is the specific, let's say, processing array that is developed by Calray, a French company, for the automotive industry. So it's a kind of proof of concept of what we are going to do for the automotive industry. At the same time, we will have also a few tiles with FPGA features, and this is something very interesting because if end users want to implement, let's say, their own algorithms in FPGA or own, let's say, cryptographic stuff in FPGA, they could. And that will get direct access to the HBM memory and we will get on the interposer, we will go with two interposer, one global interposer and two dice. So in total, for the global configuration, we could have four HBM2, 2E, and four DDR5, plus CCIX and die-to-die links on the interposer. So FPGA, MPPA, EPAC, and thus get access through the global NOC to all HBM2 and all DDR5 memory. We will get, obviously, as well, PCI Express Gen 5, top of everything. So we want to make it quite open on having access to many different technologies. And last point, we will get on board some specific cryptographic ASICs that I will not describe, obviously, that will help European Union to get full control on security aspects from an end-to-end version inside the processor and outside the processor. So one word about the European accelerator. So this is Titan. There will be basically two units in Titan. This is a vector processing unit, 1,000 bit long, with double precision FP64 compute capability. Let's say equivalent to AVX or equivalent to SSE or equivalent to SV from ARM. And there will be as well an STX feature with a stencil tensor accelerator for deep learning features working on single precision and half precision words. Something that we also intend to develop a lot is the concept of common platform. Again, it relies on the fact that we work with interposers on multi-die solutions. So let's say you have a few cores with ARM, you have the chiplet with the HBM, and then you can have a specific chiplet coming from any company. And this morning there was that presentation from Argonne. I don't remember the name of the presenter, who said that there are a big ecosystem of many different startups. And what we want to propose for many startups which don't have the money, the 100 million or so to spend for reaching the 7 nanometer or 5 nanometer manufacturing process, with our common platform, let's say API, they could plug their own IP on our chiplet, and they will get access to the best technology with direct access as well to HBM, to DDR, and so forth, not going through the classical PCI Express. So that could be a big gain for many startups, and for us, that could be a good way to extend our ecosystem. So software. Software is crucial because you could have the best hardware. If you don't have a strong ecosystem at the software level, you can forget it. So on this aspect, we just have to follow the European tradition, I would say. We build on existing projects, not only European, but mostly European. So and we intend to cover all aspects, node administration, operating systems, security by design, compilers, libraries, at first scientific libraries, development environments, and we want to develop. I will spend a bit more time on the GPP and accelerator. GPP stands for General Purpose Processing or Processor. So I'm going to explain what we want to do for having a seamless connection at the software level between the general purpose processor and accelerator. On this, we want to work with our own budgets. So it's EPI own budget plus other research and innovation budget from the Commission, the one I have described in the first presentation. And there will be also, and there is a typo, we are going also to develop the ecosystem for preparing the European Exascale Euro HPC systems. So partnership between the big labs in Europe on out of Europe, EPI, the European Commission, the big companies is very important. So time is running fast, so I will not go into the details very much. So we want to complement the existing software initiative, and we also want to work a lot on the deployment on the administrative side, especially for all the security reasons. We want to secure the processor, the BMC, on the board. All of that working with European technology. Linux is a must-have, obviously. On the end-user side, again, we don't want to create a brand new compiler. We are going to work with mostly with GCC and LLVM. And all of that makes a lot of sense when I read the list, and I will not read it. You can see it on your own. Something quite specific. Our developments, especially for the low-level tools, for security, power management, and booting mechanisms, and also for the remote control of the nodes, we have to design also specifically for the automotive industry, because they have some very, very specific real-time and operational constraints we have to fulfill, and we are going to develop in that way. And strange enough, when we look at the very first, architectural concepts coming from the HPC group and the automotive group, very often is very similar. So finding a common ground of understanding between the two worlds is not that complex. That's good news for us, because it's a good way to save money. A good example of what I say when I mentioned that we want to leverage on existing projects. Let's consider ARM. Europe has been very strong around ARM. Obviously, ARM was born in Europe, but beyond that, in Edge 2020, there were the very famous Mont Blanc research program that has been very successful on any aspect, because it's been demonstrated that it's possible to build supercomputers based on ARM, and the complete software ecosystem has been built for HPC based on ARM instruction set in Mont Blanc. In the US, there are also very good initiatives around ARM. In Japan, and I guess it is the most advanced ecosystem on ARM with Riken and Fujitsu, and also in China, where regardless all the difficulties regarding the license aspects, they invest a lot around ARM. So we can see that ARM is becoming really mainstream in HPC, so we believe that we have a big contribution from the ARM ecosystem, and we can contribute. So this is really a co-design approach we want to follow on this aspect. So one reminder about the ARM Mont Blanc 3 ecosystem. I'm moving fast because I just have 2 minutes ahead of me. So again, you can see here what we are doing in the different work packages within EPI for software. So administrative stuff mostly comes from Bull, and we are going to work as well with many reference tools. In this work package, we use a co-design approach for the definition of the global architecture, how to get the hardware, the right hardware fitting well with the applications. Automotive is very strong. It's led by BMW with Infineon, and for the software, Electrobit. Manta is a FPGA company that has a lot of very interesting features for the automotive industry. On all of that, well, you can see the global ecosystem, so many, many contributors, but it's not a closed environment. There are many possible others. And what is very interesting as well, beyond the question of the instruction set, everything we do at first for the ARM ecosystem, we can leverage to the RISC-V ecosystem. Obviously, there are some porting aspects, some specifics, but the concept is here. So we have a strong let's say, a positive move from ARM to RISC-V on the long term. And this is definitely the direction we are following in Europe. So one word about what we intend to do between the general purpose processor and the accelerator. Today, it's mostly two separate worlds, and if you want to be efficient, today, unfortunately, you've got not many solutions at the software level. You have mostly CUDA. On the side of CUDA, it's not as mature as CUDA. So what we want is to create a solution on the long term where whatever the accelerator that you plug with your general purpose processor, you use the same, let's say, software environment, the same Pragma when you develop your application. And we believe that that will be mostly around, I'm finished, but not. We believe this is mostly around OpenMP and OpenACC, but mostly OpenMP. This is the main driving direction for us. So we are going to invest a lot around OpenMP in this area. So what is quite interesting, we have started to develop an open standard with OpenMP SIMD, plus the combination with vectorization inside OpenMP, so with a masked SIMD. So we are going to get quite soon, we hope, in our simulators, let's say the addition of OpenMP SIMD plus vectorization altogether for ARM and for RISC-V, because we have a single, let's say, high-level development platform on this aspect. So let's move on to the conclusion. Oh, there is still an animation. Sorry. So for us, the big challenges for the next let's say year, for the next 12 months, will be to deliver. We have to transform R&D initiative coming from Edge 2020 into real products. And believe me, this is a big challenge because this is not the mindset of the European funded projects. So for us, it's quite tough. We are also facing a worldwide competition. And maybe you will believe me or not, but the European Commission will not use the European processor if the European processor is bad. Okay, it could be 10% worse or whatever. We could have a bit less functionalities. But if we are not globally on par with the best-in-class processors in the field, no way the European supercomputing centers work with the European processor. That's pretty simple. And we have to recreate, and this is my big challenge those days, an ecosystem at the industrial level with people. I need to hire between 200 and 300 developers for semiconductors working on big IPs with 5-nanometer manufacturing process, and finding such competencies in Europe is very difficult. Very difficult. That's it. So thank you very much. There is one question.
You mentioned that there were three sites selected. Is there anything in your procurement that says they need to be diverse from each other, or would they be the same supercomputers, the three sites for the supercomputers?
Obviously, diversity is the right answer. At this very precise moment of time, again, I cannot talk directly for the Commission, but I know what's going on. The objective, anyway, is not to get the same supercomputer in the three centers. So for a question of diversity, it's very likely that the three RFP will get different KPIs.
So Thank you very much, Jean-Marc. First question is a follow-on to that one. Is there any requirement to incorporate, at least in part, the EPI processors in these systems? And the second question is, I'm curious about your timing of the roadmap. I'm surprised that true edge, fixed edge, IoT type stuff is so far in the future. I would have thought it would have been earlier in the roadmap. But answer one or both.
Okay, so I can answer to the two questions. The first one, by law in Europe, public RFPs have to be competitive. So there will be no direct protection for the European processor in the Euro HPC procurements. End of story. Your second question is very interesting. We will get our Edge HPC microprocessor and accelerator ready by 2022. We'll get a first car running on a circuit as a prototype by 2022 as well, almost at the same time because we anticipate. But for question of regulation, certification, we don't expect to get the first cars in the real streets with our equipment before 2024. It's a question of, let's see, we don't want to have people dying because of the technology. So the certification process is very, very strong and very long. It's not a question of technology, it's a question of certification.